experiment, whenever I do anything with a slide deck, I like to start with why slide decks are bad. People in our education school have explained to me also that they're a particularly bad way of getting information. I always tell my students, be certain to have some eye candy on any slide, because otherwise, if people don't have something pretty to look at, they might pay attention to what you're saying and ask any questions. And they've also been found responsible, PowerPoint was also found responsible for the shuttle disaster with Columbia that killed 7 people. The other thing with money, this is Douglas Adams from Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and I like his quote that most of the techniques people have found to fight unhappiness on Earth involves rearranging green pieces of paper, which seems odd because the green pieces of paper are not unhappy on their own. So then, okay, money. The first societies were either barter or gift economies. You just traded things. From 9,000 6,000 BC, primarily cattle and goats. Around 1200 BC in China, they started trading shells, and then around 1000 BC, they started making metal imitations of the shells that were used as a form of currency. And currency is generally just something that we accept as a measure of value. Everyone has to accept it. An interesting example is Yapa Island in the Pacific has limestone blocks that they use as currency. There is no limestone on the island. They have to take blocks like that, put them on canoes, and bring them over. And they're rare and valuable, and they're also impossible to move. So the way the currency is handled is everybody just knows who owns which one of those blocks. They all tell each other, and that is. And we'll look later, this is a public ledger of ownership and transactions. There are blocks, and just everybody knows who owns which block, and that says who's the wealthiest person on the island. In 1816, we moved to the gold standard, and at that point, value went from, say, barter or whatever, and different coins to there were certain commodities that said what, you know, that everything was based on that. So England started using the gold standard. Everyone else went along with that. How much money a country had was based on how much gold they had in their reserves. And each piece of currency, like, you'll still find occasionally the silver notes in the U.S. currency, that you could redeem that for a certain amount of silver with the U.S. Central Bank. And that worked fairly well until the Great Depression, when money was much less available, and that really hampered the recovery of the economy. There just wasn't enough money for people to be making transactions. The money kept being more and more valuable, so it became more reasonable for you to keep your money rather than spending it. That was a good way to increase your wealth, because everything was getting cheaper. And Keynes came up with the insight that the availability of the currency helps control the economy. And at that point, things moved away from the gold standard and the central bank. So currently, the 1930 the gold standard ends. And so currently, with most every currency, the currency is worth something because the government says it's worth something, and we all accept that. And then the government, the central banks, can either increase or lower the amount of money in circulation. And that's one of the levers that they have. Where that's not the case in the monetary system, it can be problematic. For example, Europe put in place the euro, where you have a bank for Europe, and not all the countries have economies going at the same rates, and that's caused problems. For example, Germany has an economy that's booming, so they don't see any reason to print more money. Greece is having real problems, would need more money, but they don't have that much to say. Similarly, West Africa does not control their currency. Their currency is tied to the French currency, which is now the euro. And they also have problems with economic growth because they don't have a way of moving things forward with that. In 1944, the Bretton Woods Conference put in place the current international monetary system. You have the International Monetary Fund, which serves to negotiate between countries. If you have something like Argentina where they run out of money, they can go begging to the International Monetary Fund, who can give them money in exchange for control of the economy of the country. And I previously worked at the World Bank. The World Bank's tied with the IMF. They're both parts, they're both special agencies of the United Nations. Typically, the IMF is the bad cop who tells you that everyone's going to have to suffer, and the World Bank is the good cop that finds ways of going in there and trying to make things less miserable. And both of them, in general, they can, World Bank is it's part of the United Nations, but it's a private company, and it's owned by all the industrialized nations. And the percentage of control and ownership basically depends on how big your economy is. But the main thing is you have the central banks that control the money supply, and the International Monetary Fund serves as a form of mediation between them. So, summary up till now, here's an example. That's 100 trillion Zimbabwe dollars. I like, how many of you know about the Ig Nobel Prize? You should look those. They have the presentations each year online. Anyway, if you win the Ig Nobel Prize, you get a $10 trillion prize in Zimbabwe dollars. That's about 4 cents. So money is basically a medium of exchange. It has to have a limited supply. It should be hard to counterfeit. Good question?
Yes. What do you buy in Zimbabwe with that money?
Well, with $100 trillion, you could get something that's basically worth 40 cents. So, yeah, should be hard to counterfeit, and there's always a danger of hyperinflation or deflation. Hyperinflation, you have a Zimbabwe dollar where the individual units of currency become worthless. Actually, around the time that the Nazis took over in Germany, they were suffering from hyperinflation. You had to have a wheelbarrow full of money just to buy a loaf of bread. But on the other hand, you can also have deflation. The Japanese economy is having a lot of trouble because the money is becoming more and more valuable, and so people are actually buying less, which hurts the industry. Generally, you want to have a certain amount of inflation, but not too much. And okay, virtual currency. The Rothschilds banking empire controlled international banking within Europe, starting sometime in the Middle Ages. And it was a family. They did the banking, and they controlled how exchanges went from, or how money was transferred from one country to the other. And so if you had like an account with the Rothschilds in France, you could then transfer money to Denmark, and it was just within the family. They would tell the other people that they have so-and-so much money. And at that point, the bank account started taking over from a pile of currency. You didn't have to go and carry the pile of currency with you over the borders and everything. And so the bank account is now an entry on a computer disk, which then starts raising a number of questions, like what if there was an electromagnetic pulse that destroyed all the computer systems in the US, what would happen to your bank account, right? If the bank's computer isn't there anymore, do you still have money? It's a frightening question, and what the banking system has become is you've got a universal ledger of accounts, who has how much money, and it's heavily regulated. First virtual currencies started off with having a trusted intermediary. So you have somebody like Visa or American Express, where I go into a store, I have my card, I make my purchase, they accept that I'm able to do that because American Express tells them that I can do that. So I'm dealing with American Express, they're dealing with American Express, we all trust the same thing. And then with online commerce, that moved online as well. You started having, in addition to the credit card companies, you had eBay, PayPal, eGold, and a number of other things. And it was, you need that for the online transactions, right? If I'm buying something from Amazon, there has to be some way that Amazon can be certain that they're going to get their money, or why should they send me something online? So in which case, you have a middleman that's actually taking the risks, right? Somebody can and frequently does steal somebody else's credit card information and makes purchases. The credit card companies take a certain risk for doing these things, and they recover. I mean, they have losses from people stealing credit card numbers and everything, but they have fees and they make it up. And they can basically figure out how much money they need to be making for doing that. Some markets, you can have escrow accounts where, for example, with eBay, it can be that, okay, I'll buy a car from somebody on eBay, the money's put to the side, they can be certain that I've got the money's waiting for them in an account, when I get the car, they get the money. The money's at a third party that's taking care of the escrow. One point that's worth thinking about, and actually I made this point at a presentation at a computer security conference at Oak Ridge, and all of the other security experts agreed with me. You know, all of the things that they have there on the browser with the little lock and so on and so forth, it's window dressing. Actually, it doesn't work very well, it's poorly designed and so on. The security mechanism that exists is called lawyers, right? The credit card companies have lots of lawyers. They can trace where the money went. If something's going wrong, they send the lawyers to get the money back. That is basically the online security model. Well-paid lawyers. The rest of it is, one thing I find interesting, again, we're talking about the virtual currencies, is you have the online video games, the role-playing games, World of Warcraft, League of Legends, and so on, and they make these complex worlds with complex societies, and they've started hiring economists to help regulate the currencies in those worlds to keep the economies from going south, right? You have to keep that stable, things are, and it's, I imagine, a really interesting job for an economist. And you even have games that have hard and soft currencies, where they'll have some currencies that are less heavily regulated than the hard currencies, just to get around some of the issues that they've had. You also have funds going in and out of games. That's also used kind of frequently now for some money laundering by organized crime, which is a really interesting area. And then I know some of you are probably familiar with, and I guess some of you aren't, there's a thing called gold farming, which is you'll have people, some of the games you have some repetitive tasks that you have to do to go up a level, to get a magic sword, to get whatever, and then that's sold offline. So you can like get a magic sword in the game, and then you can sell it on eBay and get cash for that. There are actually some villages in India and China where you have tons of little kids playing the games, and it's a major source of income. My favorite one was that there was a story in the Guardian. It's a legitimate newspaper, so it must be true. There's a prison in China where the warden discovered that he could make more money by having the prisoners play video games than he could have by having them do hard labor. So you actually have a prison in China where you have lots of prisoners being forced to play video games 14 hours a day at gunpoint and being punished if they don't play it well enough. I sent that news story to my grad students. Actually, one of my grad students said, you know, for me, the undergraduates, that would be heaven, right? Get free room and board and as much video games as you can. So, another interesting concept is from a science fiction author, Cory Doctorow, in his book, Down and Out in the Magic Kingdom. It was a post-scarcity society where there was just enough manufactured goods. And so the currency was called Wuffy, and it was just how cool everyone thought you were. So they had like a measuring system. Everyone would be giving you, you know, like on social media, likes, dislikes, and the more likes you got, you know, the more you'd be rising up, and the more you could like get a nice table in a restaurant and so on. And then when people didn't like you, you'd go downhill. So that's which kind of, there's another idea that I've just been having going back and forth in my mind, that a lot of these things with currency and so on, it's less your physical goods, and it's more a way of having some sort of primate dominance hierarchy, right? People with more money are more dominant than people without aren't. Anyway, so banking and wire transfers, money was no longer physical pieces of paper, as pieces of information. Online commerce, you had to have these trusted third parties like escrow accounts or credit cards to do the transactions. Strangely enough, video game currencies are valuable. Just as the central bank of League of Legends is in many ways at the same level as the Federal Reserve, which is a strange idea. And then currency is moving, in some ways it's moving further away from national control to market control. You know, again, League of Legends has a central bank that controls parts of the economy just as much as the Federal Reserve, but we're getting there. And the virtual worlds have economists that work like central banks. Bitcoin. In May 2007, Satoshi Nakamoto started writing the program for Bitcoin. In 2008, Satoshi's a male name, registered Bitcoin.org. 2010, Satoshi disappeared, had no more contact with anyone. Okay. Satoshi is anonymous and a billionaire. Could be male, female, or a team. Referred to as he because Satoshi is a male Japanese name, so why not? The idea for Bitcoin was built on a number of other proposals that had been made. Some had been partially implemented, but they hadn't really taken off. And Satoshi solved many important computing problems to make the first real cryptocurrency. And Newsweek is the only place on earth that believes that the man in the picture is Satoshi Nakamoto. He's a man that has the unfortunate characteristic of having the same name as Satoshi Nakamoto, the fictional character, and Newsweek was thrilled when they found him, but it really turns out that it's very, very unlikely that the man in the picture, and he's probably just confused as to what's going on. The first problem that had to be solved, had been solved but not put in this context, is called the Byzantine General's Problem. That's low-end computing problem, which actually a large part of my dissertation was based on. Lamport was looking at how you can make distributed systems that actually work. And with Murphy's Law, you know that anything that can go wrong will, and that's probably an optimistic way of viewing things. So how can you design things that actually work? And so he came up with a metaphor that he used for solving a number of the problems. And the metaphor is the Byzantine Empire. So the Eastern Roman Empire, when the Roman Empire split in two, was notoriously corrupt. So the idea is you're a general in the Byzantine Empire, and you know that many of your colleagues are corrupt and working for the other side. So how can the loyal generals as a group make decisions when you know parts of your group are conspiring against you? And the basic insight was to just allow all of the bad things that could happen to conspire to work as well as possible, to be as intelligent as possible, to make things go bad. And he came up with some basic insights. Insight number one, you can't have more than a third of the group be corrupt. Actually, it has to be less than a third of the group. And the basic point is, say I have two friends, right? This friend and that friend. And I tell this friend, you know, I'm on your side. That guy over there thinks you're a jerk. And then I tell this friend, you know, I'm on your side. This guy over there is really trying to do something bad to you. You have no way of knowing, right? You have absolutely no way of knowing who's telling the truth between the three of you. You have to have less than one third. So if you have more than two thirds agreeing, it's cool. There's another thing with, you know, where the information flows. And there are solutions to that, and it's been set up for distributed databases and so on. And in this case, what you're going to do is you have a distributed system, and you've got what are called miners that are verifying the transactions. And you set up a competition between them, and most all of them have to agree. You have no centralized point of control, and the things are all working independently. And so if you're going to do a hack of the system, you have a number of different copies of the database. Some of them might be, you have a number of different copies of the database, and if you're going to corrupt it, you have to change at least two-thirds of them simultaneously. So again, with Bitcoin, you have copies of the centralized database that are all over the world. Your ability to get into two-thirds of them at the same time and make the same change is challenging. The next thing is the blockchain. And with the blockchain, if I'm giving money to my postdoc Lou, I make the transaction, I say, okay, you know, I give them the ID of my Bitcoin, and I say, I'm transferring it to Lou, and I have, it's called a public key cryptography. You have a key that everyone can use, and I have a key that I don't give to anybody else under any conditions, definitely not my friends and family. Okay, and so I use the private key. Okay, you take a hash of the transaction, which means you come up with a random number that you can get from that, but you can't go back any other way. I encrypt that. Anybody with a public key can then verify that whoever had the private key did that, but not. But if you don't have a private key, you can't do that. So I did that for my transaction. I send that to the miners. We'll talk about miners later. And they put them all into a set of blocks. So each transaction is signed by the person making the transaction. It's put into a block. You have the miners that are competing for the ability to make the next block. They do it. The first person to, we'll go into how the miners work later, but the first person to be able to make the block gets a reward for it, puts it into the blockchain. Then the next block uses a hash of the entire block, which was signed by me, the miner, and that goes into the next block. So that means for you to change, my transaction, you would need, let's say I made a transaction 3 weeks ago. For you to change it, you would need my secret key, so you would have had my system. You would need the secret key of the miner who made the block, so you'd have to also break into their machine to get their thing to forge it. And then you would need the secret key of the miner that made the next block, and so on. So the further back you go, not only do you have to break into 2/3 of the machines that have copies of the database, but then you have to have broken into and have gotten these keys from all these people who are not connected together all over the world. And basically, it becomes functionally impossible for that to occur. I mean, for you to have the ability to do that would be amazing, and this is being done in real time as well. So you'd have to break in all those machines, get the keys, make this change, distribute the change to 2/3 of these nodes, distribute it over the entire world, and so, which gets into why this approach is really interesting, because any database, it can have the crappiest security imaginable, but it doesn't really matter. You've got a lot of systems that can be poorly maintained, but in the aggregate, it becomes impossible to make a change to the system that's not a legitimate change. Mining is you take, again, if I'm a miner, I get a set of transactions. There's a problem that I have to solve to create the block. And I verify the transactions. I can get a hash of the block. The hash, as I said, is a random number that you get from the data that you input. There's an algorithm that gives it to you. From the random number, you can't go back easily the blocks. And in this case, for Bitcoin, you have the block that you've got and a random number that you have to find. You have to come up with a random number such that the hash that you get out of it starts with a certain number of zeros. Okay? There's no way of going back from the hash to the inputs, so you have to just try a whole bunch of these numbers until you get the right number. And that's called proof of work for Bitcoin. And again, you just try one random number after the other. The first miner that solves it gets a new Bitcoin together with any transaction fees that we put into the transactions. You can, again, I'm transferring the money to Lou. I can, to be certain that the transaction occurs more quickly, I can put in transaction fees. The more money you put into the transaction fee, the quicker that you're, right? If I'm willing to pay 2 cents, eventually my thing's gonna get into the blockchain. If I'm willing to pay $80, I'm going to get in there much more quickly. It's like going to a fancy restaurant and giving tips on the date, right? So, one thing that's important for Bitcoin, because it is a currency, you don't want to have a lot of inflation or you end up with a Zimbabwe dollar. So, and doing mining creates new Bitcoins. So what they did was, it's built into the system that the system makes a new block every 10 minutes. If the last block was in there really quickly, you force them to have more zeros to slow the system down. And that's how you really guarantee that the system keeps its value, because there's only a limited number of Bitcoin that are ever going to be made. That's not going to change, and it's not going to start having a lot of inflation. As it stands now, the energy for creating one block would heat an average house for a week. And they now have, actually, for Bitcoin now, if you're not actively involved, it's probably not worthwhile getting involved. They have these gigantic, Mongolia, they have like gigantic factories full of CPUs just working on this. China's kind of cornered the market, and you now have chips that are made specifically for solving the hashes very quickly, and they have these massively parallel systems for that. My understanding is Bitcoin mining is not that reasonable nowadays. Monero is actually where you should be doing mining if you want to get money from that. So Bitcoin is a working system, and if you'll remember the Yappy's currency, which was the limestone blocks, that all worked by having a public ledger of who owned the limestone blocks. This is the same thing. You have a public ledger of which Bitcoin addresses have the Bitcoins. The transactions are independently verified by miners, and that means that there are at least tens of thousands of groups of people all over the world trying to do the computation to get the money from that. And it's universally stored. I mean, if you want to, you can have one of your nodes join it and have a copy of the entire database. So it's all over the world. Malicious modification of that ledger is effectively impossible, and the value is guaranteed because there's a limited number of Bitcoin. There's a limited number of Bitcoin now. There's only going to be a limited number. Now, this has caused a whole lot of changes in the world. For example, here we have Southwest Asia number 4 heroin, which you can buy online, or cocaine, if you prefer, with free shipping. That started in 2011. Ross Ulbricht developed the Silk Road. He's now convicted and is in prison. The FBI tracked him and found him by tracking his network use. They didn't track him for Bitcoin. He set up a dark website. That's a website that you have to use the Onion router to get there, and then also having Bitcoin transactions. And his insight was he basically did something similar to eBay. He set up a website where people could sell their merchandise, and you had anonymous access to it. You then had anonymous transactions with Bitcoin. And the other thing was, which was, I don't know, genius or whatever, was he allowed the users to rate the suppliers. So that when you go there, you could see, oh, everybody likes this heroin much better than that heroin, so it's a much better deal. I will do that. He was in jail. Alphabay became the replacement, And the people running Alpha Bay were thrown in jail earlier this year. Alpha Bay was caught because if you lost your password, there was an email link to get your password reset, which went to the guy who was running its Gmail address. So that, oops. So it's, you had online market, the user reviews, and then also escrow accounts. So if you don't trust your heroin dealer, you would trust the guy running Silk Road. You make the purchase, you give the guy running Silk Road the Bitcoin, and then when you get the heroin, it would be released. One thing that always bothered me about this business model, I just thought, why would anyone do that, is the people selling drugs or whatever, they send it to a physical postal address. And, you know, while it might not be my house, it might be the old lady across the street or whatever, I was just thinking, why would I give a postal address that I have access to some random weirdo? Just doesn't seem like a good idea. And then I read someplace and it actually started making sense. It's safer to do that than to go to a bad part of town with a large amount of cash in your money and try and buy drugs. That's actually much more dangerous. Hadn't occurred to me right off, but then when that idea was presented to me, that made sense. Okay, here you can buy credit cards, hacking services, and let me see, guns. Now, my student in South Carolina said, guns is a stupid hat there because you can just go to the gun show and get it anyway. But there was a case in Munich about 2 years ago where there was a mass shooter who had bought his guns on the dark web. And getting guns in Germany is not that easy a thing, unless you're going through the dark web. Or there's hitman services. Now, many of these things, I kind of suspect might be scams. Or if they're not Department of Justice scams, they, should be. I mean, why are we giving our money to the government for if we're not doing that type of thing? You buy counterfeit currency, you can buy counterfeit passports, and so on. And I kind of liked this. Is Bitcoin the only form of payment, and Bitcoin secure and anonymous? They don't take anything else, just Bitcoin. They'll ship worldwide. 100% safe and discreet. Again, I don't know if I would trust these people, but. Okay, so Silk Road with contraband markets, Silk Road found a real demand, and it's less risky to do the transactions like this over the dark web than it is showing up in person with large amounts of cash. All sorts of things are available. Law enforcement is adapting to it, adapting to these sorts of marketplaces, and they've been being successful. I'm on a tour development email group, and it was kind of weird. They, with one of the dark websites that the FBI busted, it was a kiddie porn ring, and it was just a really weird email traffic because I can understand that they were upset that the FBI found a hole in their security, but on the other hand, that they arrested somebody that's doing kiddie porn, I couldn't really get up about it. One of my favorite, and that one's down, so I don't know what happened to that. I found a really great website of somebody offering services where they would implement dark websites for selling illegal goods to Bitcoin. They would build in the Bitcoin wallets, and they would just take a percent of the things. And I was just, that CGI programming is now the essential skill set for organized crime. It's just a really weird idea. Okay, Bitcoin is not the only coin. Ethereum is the next one. I mean, if you look, this is from about 2-3 months. I got it from John's paper, the one we had in there. This is from ago, I mean, Bitcoin went up over $10,000. It changes about hourly. So, but the $9 trillion value of Bitcoin is probably conservative. It's quite a bit more than that now. Ethereum is the next one with 900 billion. Ripple has 200 billion, and so on. So there's a lot of money out there, and there's a lot of people trusting these things. The technology is really interesting. Ethereum is a particularly interesting one. It's the second largest one. What's really fascinating about that is the transactions include a scripting language. So that means when you transfer money to the other person, it includes a program. It's an intelligent contract. So that means when you pay the money enforces the contract. So, you know, I'll give you $100,000 when you do this. I'm giving the money, and the money is only going to let you spend it after it can prove that you've done what you promised. Just an incredibly interesting idea, and it kind of implies that when you think about it in the future, you're going to have a profession where you're going to need finance skills, you're going to need legal skills, and you're going to need to know how to program these systems in order to make contracts. Just a fascinating idea. There have been bugs. There was a notable one where somebody stole $58 million about a year ago, and then they had to, they rewound the, all of the, you know, sort of like one of those Superman movies where it goes back in time. They went back in time for a month and then started over with those people having their $58 million again. And there's no telling what sort of bugs might be in there for the future. So I'm not taking all of my money and buying Ethereum, but it's a fascinating idea. There are different ways of doing mining. We talked some about how Bitcoin does it with the proof of work. You find this random number. Purecoin does proof of stake, which is the person with the most Purecoin gets to make the new transactions. Kind of like Wall Street. The people with the most money get to control how the things work. There's a logic behind that because if you've got like $1 million invested in Purecoin, you don't want people to lose their trust in Purecoin. So they have a reason to make certain that things are going well. You also have, okay, proof of retrievability. They're using this idea to also set up a big distributed file system. So then you can then store a lot of data on your disk, and then they use proof of retrievability to do the mining. You have to prove that you've got parts of the data on your disk in order to get the transaction fees. So in which case, that's using it for something else. NIM has proof of importance, which if you remember, WUFI is about the same thing. How much everybody thinks you're cool. We have a lightweight mining approach that we're using. I'll get to our project later and discuss that. Hash functions. I discussed hash functions earlier, and you use it. And it's very important to make a good hash function. Bad hash function there would be one where you've got a pattern that can be exploited. A good hash function there would be you've got your inputs, you've got the hash value, and there's no telling. Most of them use SHA-256, which is the NIST standard cryptographic hash that's approved by the people at the NSA, which is about as good as you're going to get with cryptography. There are other ones that are being used. Script requires a lot of memory and it's hard to verify. Ethereum has its own, which was designed so that, remember I said with the miners that they're starting to have specially designed chips that do that. ETH is set up to avoid that. X11 is 11 different ones right after the other, and then there's also Kryptonite, where I have to admit I misspelled it, but I didn't know I changed it. Privacy, I'm kind of going further than I am. It's taking more time than I thought, so I'm going to go a bit faster now. Bitcoin has a number of privacy features. With each transaction that you have, you use a different private key, which gives you a different address. There's also Monero, which mixes your sender your address with others and hides the destination address and also hides the amount. So it's more privacy enhanced than Bitcoin. And Bitcoin has a number of features that makes it hard. Zcash and Zcoin were put together by cryptographers, and there's looking directly at the transactions. You cannot make a clear connection between the sender and the receiver. It does put all the transactions into a common pool of transactions, and I think there are things that could be done there. Dash, which was formerly Darkcoin, I actually found out about it at a human rights conference. I was just talking to the guy next to me, and it turns out that he and his partner do tech support for the legal marijuana industry. And the legal marijuana industry has standardized on using Dash, and a lot of that is that they, although the marijuana industry is legal in the states where it's legal, marijuana is still illegal for the federal government, and the federal government regulates the banks. So these businesses cannot have a bank account, okay? And they cannot have a bank account, and interstate transfers of funds would also be problematic for them, so it makes sense that they use cryptocurrencies, and it also makes sense that they would use one that's designed to make it hard to follow what's going on. Online, you can also find mixing services, which are there for some form of money laundering. The basic thing, these are commercial services. If I want to do a transfer to Lou, I make the transfer, and their promise is they'll take the money I give them, cut it up into little pieces, give it to somebody, who'll give it to somebody, who'll give it to somebody, and they'll give it to Lou minus a little fee in the middle. We're interested in trying to look at the money laundering. It's an interesting problem, how that's being done online and how you could counteract that. Just what information is available for tracing those things. And really interesting. Our project is basically set up, the National Science Foundation wanted a way of securing Provenance Metadata, it's just information about transactions. And from our point of view, well, you've got this technology that comes up with these distributed things where you can't change any of the transactions. We should take as much of that as we can and adopt it. However, it would be kind of foolish to safeguard that where for every transaction, you have to use as much energy as we use to heat a house for a week. That doesn't make a lot of sense. So we've come up with our lightweight mining program, which is basically the security of each transaction is the same as you would have for Bitcoin. It's just you've got signatures and hashes, and nobody's going to mess with that. And then you can't just rely on a single entity to do the transactions. So we choose the miner at random, which lets us save a lot of energy. We're using that to safeguard academic integrity. We're using that to safeguard the security laws of computers. Somebody hacks into your machine, the first thing they're gonna do is destroy the security logs so they have no way of seeing what happened in your machine. This way we can see if the security logs we can tamper with. Also looking at, and I have some colleagues that work from the FBI and the Computer Emergency Response Team at Carnegie Mellon. We talked with them. They do computer forensics, so they arrest somebody for having child pornography, and the first thing you do is you take their computer, you take it to the lab, they make a copy of the disk, they do a hash of the disk so that they can show that things weren't tampered with. The idea is, but with that, you have to keep, with any of the forensic stuff, you have to keep a very strong record of the chain of custody, like in any of the police programs on TV, right? where is the evidence stored, who had access to the evidence. In this case, we can then just take the hash that they had of the disk, we can say who did that at what time, and it would be very difficult for a defense attorney to come back and say, oh, they planted something on my client's disk after the fact. I mean, if you have a corrupt technician that does it immediately after the person's machine is impounded, we can't say anything like that, but we can say who made a copy of the disk, when, and if there was tampering after the fact. Conclusions? Where one of the things I hope you got from the talk is that cryptocurrency is kind of a natural evolution of money, right? Start off with cows, then you had coins, then you had gold, then you had credit cards, and limestone blocks in between. This is about the same thing. To set it up, you need to solve some hard technical problems, and by doing that in an elegant way, they were able to integrate a lot of concepts and did that. The combination of the cryptocurrencies and the dark web has set up a number of things that are socially interesting and challenging. Altcoins are disrupting finance and commerce, and what's going to happen with that. Privacy and money laundering, and that sets up a number of both technical and social challenges. Okay? Privacy is a good goal. Money laundering, probably less so, but there's a definite conflict there. And the project that we have is ongoing and has a number of promising aspects. Basically, yeah. Is there any questions, comments? Unless there's some NSA employee who's moonlighting and doing that for fun, I kind of doubt that that's all that useful.
I just want to say that I think this is still the beginning, and that the Bitcoin craze is we haven't seen. This is just the beginning of it. Like, it's going to be out of control. Like how Finney said that in the future, people who own Bitcoin now, this is like 2009, 10, he said it will be as rare as people own it today. And that's true. And 10 years from now, no one's going to have Bitcoin. It will be that scarce, sought after, and important. So if you can acquire any Satoshis you can right now, that's my advice. I think it's going to get absolutely so out of control.
There's a limited number, right?
So yeah.
It's
like 68,000 Satoshis per person on the planet. Which you can get 15,000 right now for a dollar. Yeah. It's something to think about.
I'm not necessarily advising you.
Oh, I'm not advising you. I'm just saying that in my perspective, it's going to get out of control. The youth has already decided that this is the currency we're going to use.
It's not necessarily wrong, but there are going to be, the fact that you now have, for example, if I was in Zimbabwe, with a lot of countries on Earth, I would definitely be using cryptocurrencies instead of local currencies.
I've tried it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
they're using Bitcoin now.
There's only one.
No. What happened after the Bitcoin? Bitcoin is in Zimbabwe.
Oh, in Zimbabwe. Yeah. In West Africa, there's only one person that's running the Bitcoin system, which kind of surprised me.
Based on looking at the list of currencies, outline, where do you see this virtual currency, Bitcoin, whatever comes after it, becoming mainstream? At what point?
I'm fascinated by the ideas behind Ethereum. I mean, just the idea of having the money enforce the contract. I think that there's things along those lines are probably where something would go. And then, again, if you start thinking about it, you're going to, when you buy your house, you're going to want a lawyer with programming skills as well. And think about what they're going to be earning with that. Like with your house, you also have to buy the title insurance and all that. It would be very interesting to have something like that embedded in the money, or another thing with that. I've been doing a lot of work with freedom of expression in West Africa. And I've talked to some people there with a number of government functions, right? It would be reasonable, like your birth certificate, instead of having a piece of paper, some sort of blockchain like that to store information as to your personal data and things like that would be useful, right?
I think the state of Illinois is actually working on that, trying to
blockchainify
birth certificates. It's super exciting.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, for example, the person I was talking with is with the government of Guinea, and with a lot of the African governments. You can have trouble with corruption. You can have trouble also with having faith in the correctness of the documents. With something like this, that would be one way of alleviating a lot of those problems and concerns. There are a lot of things in that sort of direction where you see things going. I'm not certain that money is the final application for a lot of these things. Although money is, of course, important. As we all know.
With the cryptocurrencies having the potential to be having anonymous transactions, how would governments try to go after cryptocurrency transactions?
Tony and I are trying to write a number of grant proposals based on those sorts of questions. I mean, how can you track the things? I mean, one of the weak points of current systems is if you were living your entire life with cryptocurrencies, but you're not, So the money's going in and out of the system. And so that would be one weak point. But there are a number of different things. Another question, which I just posed this morning, is you have laws against doing your financial transactions in ways that avoid the government tracking and regulations. So, I don't know, Monero and Zcash, that seems like their entire business model. So I'm just kind of curious as to what the legal status is, or how that relates to that. And I frankly don't know. And I mean, to a certain extent, again, another question is how, for example, the mixers that they have there, I don't know, that seems really weak. Outside the question if I would trust somebody who's advertising on a dark website with $10,000 of my money, which is a real question, just the model that they have for giving money to somebody, or they, you give them money and they'll mix the money with the other people that are giving them money to launder, and then they'll give you something that can't be traced directly back to you. Well, I mean, great. So that means that my marijuana purchase will be mixed with heroin dealers, hitmen, and kitty porn. I'm not certain that that's really a good idea, and there's definitely a lack of transparency in that model. So there's a lot of challenges there. And of course, everybody that set up one of these things claims that it's absolutely foolproof and secure. And some of the people that set up some of these things are very talented and well respected. So I can't dismiss it out of hand, but I'm curious.
So how would the quantum computing, would the quantum computing disrupt this or actually make this more popular?
Okay. Why is that Penn State, the guy in the room next to me, developed a quantum computer that worked with 1 qubit, that's like 15, 16 years ago. Like 17, 18 or so. He built a quantum computer that was all with photons and was able to do the computation with 1 qubit, but I haven't. Okay. Answer one, I have no clue. Answer number two, I'm not necessarily convinced that quantum computing is going to be there in the recent future. I mean, I'm not willing to say that it's not going to be there, but there have been a number of different problems with that. With one of the issues is, of course, the public key. It's going to be problematic for the public key crypto with being able to decipher them. If it lives up to the promises and if it actually is working, so that'd be one problem. Another problem would be, for example, with the mining, right? If you can take the problem instead of sequentially trying a bunch of different numbers or in parallel trying it a bunch of different numbers, you pose the problem to the quantum gods in the multiverse and they deliver, all of the multiverses trying in parallel and it magically delivers the correct answer, then that would also be problematic. I mean, I took a college course in quantum physics and was being confused. So I can't really, that's about the limit of the knowledge I have, but it appears to be problematic in the future. If it really does pan out, then yeah, there are a number of issues that will happen. And one thing that could be interesting would be to try and think about how you could, if you actually have that and you have the quantum entanglement for making transactions, it'd be interesting to look at that. I mean, there are things that could be done, and it would be radically different. And I don't know enough to say which one.
And then here you go with the Zcash Arc system implementation.
Yeah, that's the Zcash.
Well.
Zcoin, Matthew Green and Johns Hopkins.
Ethereum's in a multiverse application of that in the future. It's pretty interesting.
Yeah, the problem I've seen with that, two things that concern me about that. And again, the person that Matthew Green has done that is very, very highly respected and is working at my alma mater, so hey, I can't say anything bad about them. Two things that concern me. The one thing that concerns me is with the implementation, some of it seems to be bordering on security through obscurity. Some of it's just been made like really complicated, and I'm not certain if it's really adding to the security or just making it hard to follow.
Sure.
I mean, I don't know. And then the other thing that where I'm trying to write a proposal to attack that is, okay, so they put everything in a pool for making the transactions, right? But with other things like the onion router, there are attacks on that where if you can look, and we've got the public ledger, if you can look at the entire pool, there's a definite side channel of, you know, like I'm putting in something here and somebody's taking something out there at about the same time, even though you can't say what happened in this cloud, that's kind of suspicious. And I'm trying to get the time to look at that in detail. So I don't know, and I would be willing to take on faith that crypto's probably not involved. Except for the whole attendant problem more complicated than it should be.
I have a question. You stated that the underlying information of cryptocurrencies is in blockchain to verify the transactions of the market. Now, you also hinted that this blockchain can also be used in other things other than cryptocurrency. So, as we incorporate other things like certificates we've been putting into IDs or anything else like that, what is your prediction about the complexity on doing those certifications? Because if you get more transactions, you have to need more monitors to do those certifications. And even by all the cryptocurrency, it seems like we have lots of warehouses set up just to verify those transactions, and as we incorporate more,
the verifications are the inputs that are going into the system. That's the individual transactions, and then you're putting together, put in this block, right?
Right.
So, and that is sanity checking, and then, you know, they check that the inputs are all valid. And a lot of the largest part of the complexity for what the miner's doing is to fight inflation, to limit the number of things going in, which for the other applications would not be. Now, the verification after the fact, framed it simple and really fast. Okay, because you can just check. You can check the hashes based on the everything, and checking a hash is framed it fast. It's just finding the hash. Finding the hash for those properties, that's hard.
So
and so you would have to, I mean, okay, verifying the transaction within the block would take like no time. If you're going to verify the validity from the most recent block going all the way back, that would take like a little bit of time to go all the way back. But you wouldn't really need to do that. If you're going like three or four blocks forward to check that those hashes are good, you can kind of take on faith that a hash from 5 months ago. You know, you don't have to necessarily go through the all of the data from now back 5 months. You have the copies that are kind of accepted, so that's, I mean, it depends on how paranoid you want to be, but I don't think that that's absolutely necessary. And my job has turned me into paranoid one night.
Thank our speaker, and we're...